Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Wow. What a great morning. Get to look out across the crowd and see lots of old friends, lots of new friends. And, it's so wonderful that during this beautiful weather we're having that you all took time out of your day to come in and worship our Lord.
Amen.
Before I get into all the announcements and the order of service, let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear God, our gracious and heavenly Father, thank you for this glorious day. Thank you for all these wonderful believers that are sitting in the audience before me. And Lord, thank you for the people that are online watching and listening today. And we pray that your presence will be felt not only here, but there as well. Lord, we ask and pray that you'll continue to be with us and touch each and every one of our hearts, minds, and bodies, and give us the strength to serve you to our fullest capacity. Lord, thanks again for all the wonderful blessings that you bestowed upon us. And we ask and pray in your Son Jesus Christ's name that you will be there with us step by step, holding us in your right hand. In Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
So, I'm going to get into, first of all, the announcements. Before I do that, I think I know a lot of you, probably almost all of you. But anyway, my name is Brett Leach, and I'm going to be here later just today. So, first of all, altar flowers are in honor of Patty Covington's 24th birthday. Patty's 74th birthday. So, I don't see Patty. Is she here today?
Well, Patty, come here.
Okay, not here today. Anyway, Patty, if you're watching online, we love you and we wish you a very happy birthday. If you're a first-time guest or a regular attendee, please fill out the back portion of your bulletin and pull it out, put it in the offering box, and, especially if you have any prayer concerns or needs. If you're a volunteer with the children of the youth of our church, it's time for you to renew your safe sanctuary. It's a not only good business, but it's a legal requirement, so we need you to do that. If you need to, you can email Emily or reach out, and she'll help you get to that online training. You can sign up for the Dinner of Six by scanning the QR code. So how many of you know what the Dinner of Six actually is? All right, we've got four, five, six. We're actually running it, so.
Oh, we've got that. Oh, look at that.
I can't count that high, so I'm not even going to try to count that many. So what is the Dinner of Six? So Beth Raber is the chairman of our Nurture Committee. And she brought me up a little cheat sheet she'd like for me to share with you. So, Dinner for Six is for those people that are interested in getting acquainted with each other, as we have lots of new members over the past several years. We say hi to each other when we see you in church, but we really don't get to know each other. This was done in the past when we were fairly new, and in a good way to get to really know all the wonderful people in the congregation and bond with the people in our church. Todd, were they doing Dinner of Six whenever you were preaching here? What do you got?
Not really Dinner for Six, but
we did
kind of
more informal. Okay, more informal. All right. How does it work? You sign up. Groups are put together, and you'll be notified by a group leader. And the group decides on when they get together for social gatherings and potlucks. The host does the main course and drinks, and the others bring side dishes. This can occur over 3 months. And we can redo the groups if you want to continue being involved. How do you sign up? Well, you can take a picture of the barcode in your bulletin with your phone. It'll bring you up the sign-in sheet, fill it out, and submit it. And it'll go to the church office. Otherwise, Beth will be at the back of the church, and she will sign you up if you'll give her a name and phone number if you're interested. So, anyway, for those of you that don't know Beth Rayburn, raise your hand, Beth. Let everybody see you. All right. So, that is Dinner of Six in a nutshell. Second of all, announcements we have. Make sure you fill out the church survey. As you know, we're kind of at a new beginning, or a continuation of our existing beginning as we move through trying to determine where we're going with our church, the priorities and our outreaches, and new things we want to take on, and old things we want to take off. So please fill out the church survey. It's online. Should have been mailed to you, and there's also a hard copy at the back of the church. We'd love to hear your input as we go forward. Feed the People is happening tomorrow at 3:30 at the warehouse, and the community dinner will follow at 5:30. This upcoming Saturday, the 22nd, there will be a picnic in the clouds from 11:30 to 1:30 at the Picnic Pavilion on the main road. I can't say that fast 3 times.
Cloud
Rock. Cloud Rock? Well, that was a really nice thing that should have been included.
It was.
So anyone that wants a beautiful drive to Cloud Rock? Saturday. Be there.
At the park.
And if you have ever been on a walk to Emmaus or are interested in going on a walk to Emmaus, you should attend this event. We need pilgrims for the men and women's walk to Emmaus. Men's walk is August 17th through 20th. Women's walk is 7th through the 10th. If you know that someone that's interested in going and participating, contact Penny Chilton, who you'll meet in a few minutes. If you don't already know her, Ed McLeod, Emily Beltran, or Dustin McHugh, once he gets back from Scotland. All right, I think that is all of that. So now, as you probably have noticed, it's going to be a little bit old school, a little bit new school, in that none of the screens are working. So we're going back old school, the paper, and also the hymnals, new school, and we're still live streaming. So it's not going to help you if you're sitting down. With that, let's go to the call to worship, and it was included in the handout for today. Let me get to that. This is from Psalm 55. Everybody have it? Everybody please rise. Come bring all that you are to God, who hears our prayers and does not hide from our supplication.
God is more faithful than our closest companions.
Call upon God, our Savior, for he hears your voice and will redeem you. Cast your burden on the Lord, and he will sustain you.
Let us trust him and worship our God together.
And while you're still standing, I'm in love with all this. I'll turn your song reader for today. And I think it's on. It's on?
Thank you for their love for you. I just ask that you be with them now. And Lord, I ask that you be with my friend, Lois. Lord, hear our prayers.
Rick Misra.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Tony Ferguson.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Brett Leach.
Lord, hear our prayers.
James and Linda.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Steve Jones.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Imagination Station.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Gina and Wayne.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Chris Bagley.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Laura.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Our visitors.
Lord, hear our prayers.
The Linden family.
Lord, hear our prayers.
The scouts of the trail.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Governors all over the world.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Jack Payton family.
Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers.
Father, you have heard the names that we have called out and so many more that are unmentioned. But you already know the needs, and we thank you for that. I ask your blessings on each name that was mentioned. I ask your healing. I ask your best plans. I ask your perfect will. And now, as we all pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I believe in
God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the
Don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in synagogues where everyone can see them. I tell you the truth, that is all the reward that they will ever get. But when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father, who sees everything, will reward you. When you pray, don't babble on like the Gentiles do. They think that their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need, and even before you ask him. Pray like this: Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please bow your heads. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my
ago. And we're so grateful to be members of this church, this faith family, this body of believers and followers of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This morning I want to talk about prayer. You may have figured that out because you've already heard the Lord's Prayer 3 times. And thank you for the special music. I don't know where Mel was sitting, but that was beautiful. Thank you. Made me cry. And I already had a runny nose, so thanks a lot. What is prayer? Prayer is simply a heartfelt conversation between God and His child, and that is you. Prayer is good. It's not a job, it's a privilege. It's the act of bringing heaven to earth, to you, to your circumstances, and to the lives of those you love. It's one of the highest forms of worship. It's one of the most reverent and yet one of the most real and basic ways to express ourselves before our Heavenly Father. And it's a common factor in the life of most believers. It's the way that we communicate with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But it's also a hard habit to get into and an easy one to forget about. Do you struggle at times with prayer? If so, you're not alone. We all struggle with this at times, trying to figure out how to pray for a situation or a person. What's the Father's will in this instance? How should I express myself to the Father to convey what I really mean? I'm sure all of us have wondered at one time or another, is there a right way or a wrong way to pray? Is there a right or wrong time to pray? Does God hear my prayers? And if so, why isn't he answering my prayers? I'm not answering any of those questions today. I don't have to think about them. Seriously, I hope to shed some light on some of these issues today. I want to start by sharing something that I read in Max Lucado's book, Pocket Prayers. We aren't the first to struggle with prayer. The sign-up sheet for the beginner's class Prayer 101 contains some familiar names, the apostles John, James, Andrew, and Peter. When one of Jesus' disciples requested, "Lord, teach us to pray," none of the others objected. No one walked away saying, "I have prayer figured out." The first followers of Jesus needed prayer guidance. In fact, the only tutorial they ever requested was on prayer. They could have asked for instructions on many topics: bread multiplying, speech making, storm stilling. Jesus raised people from the dead. But how to vacate the cemetery class was never asked for. But they did ask him for one thing: "Lord, teach us to pray." As we read earlier in Matthew 6, verses 5 through 8, we're told not to pray piously. At that time in biblical history, and actually even today, the Jewish culture encouraged the routine of prayers being offered at specific times during the day. Now, the Pharisees would typically make it a point to be in the synagogue or in a public place when it was time to pray so that many people would see them and hear their public displays. And the Bible tells us that the only attention that they will ever, the only reward they will ever receive is the attention from the onlookers that happened to be around them at that time. And then there are the Gentiles, that would be you and me. He tells us not to repeat ourselves over and over. He tells us not to repeat ourselves over and over. So, what is necessary? Psalm chapter 15, verses 16 through 17 read, "Going through the motions doesn't please you. A flawless performance is nothing to you. I learned God worship when my pride was shattered. Heart-shattered lives, ready for love, don't for a moment escape God's notice." That same scripture, verse 17 in another translation says, "The sacrifice God wants is a broken spirit. God will not reject a heart that is broken and sorry for sin." We're commanded to confess our sins, to ask for forgiveness, accept God's gracious gift of forgiveness. That sometimes is the hard part for us. Accept his forgiveness. And then turn from that sin, that choice, that lifestyle, and sin no more. Whenever our son Brian was 11 or 12 years old, he made his public profession of faith. And it was amazing. But at the end of the service, whenever we got in the car, he turned to me and he said, "Mama, does this mean that I'm never going to sin again?" And I said, "Yes, that's exactly what I mean." But then I had to explain to him, no, that is not what that means. Is there a right or a wrong time to pray? There's never a wrong time to pray. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17 tells us to never stop praying. This doesn't mean that during a meeting at work or during a conversation with someone, you have to say, "Excuse me, I need to go to a quiet place or to my prayer closet because I need to have a little chat with God, because I'm not sure how to respond to you at this particular moment. No, we need to internally, not out loud, ask God how He would have us respond to someone who is pouring their heart out to us, whether it be a line at Walmart or a conversation in the aisle here at church, either before or after the services. We are to always be asking the Holy Spirit, which is God living in us and working through us, to make us aware when we need to lift people or situations up in prayer as Holy Spirit brings them to our minds. Sentence prayers, heart prayers, communicating with God, allowing Holy Spirit to speak to us and through us. It's at these times that we're allowing God to use us as His instruments of love and grace. But another issue might be anger with God over unanswered prayers. See, here's the thing. I don't believe there's such a thing as unanswered prayers. I believe God answers all of our prayers. He just doesn't always answer them in the way we want. Sometimes His answer will be no. At other times, it will be yes. And sometimes it'll be not now. Wait. Let's say you have a small child who really, really, really wants a piece of candy. But he or she hasn't eaten anything substantial that day. They want that candy. They need that candy. It's exactly what will bring them joy and contentment and a sense of well-being. But you're their parent. Their good and loving and wise parent. You know better. Your answer isn't going to be yes. It will either be a flat out no, or it will be a not now. Wait. As a parent, we know what's best for our children. But what about us? Most of us aren't children. Why can't we have what we want? What about that new car, or a better job, or better health, or resolution to a broken relationship? We want those things, either for ourselves or for those that we love. John chapter 14, verse 13 says, "You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it." So that's why. Why do we ask? So that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Sometimes what we ask for is for ourselves. It's not to bring glory to the Father. Because see, it isn't always about us. I struggle with that sometimes. But it isn't always about us or what we want. We can't see the big picture. God created the big picture. It's about God's plans being carried out to bring glory to the Father. Matthew 6:10, "May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." When I was a hospice chaplain, there was a daughter of a patient who was dying from cancer. As we spoke, she became angry and asked, "You mean God knew my dad was going to have cancer?" I explained to her that God knows everything. Nothing is a surprise to Him. Nothing catches Him off guard. Nothing causes Him to have to scramble for a solution. But I also told her that we live in a fallen world. A world full of sin, a world filled with water pollution, air pollution, foods filled with preservatives, chemicals, and hormones. And by the way, her father's career was selling deep fried foods at carnivals. So, did God know her dad would have cancer? Yes. Did God cause her father to have cancer? No. Some people don't get that. Some people think that God is an angry God looking down on earth, just waiting for us to mess up so He can punish us. This is what Satan wants each and every one of us to visualize when we think of God. Don't do it. This is a lie from the evil one. Our God is a loving God, a caring God, and He wants the best for us. So, why do some people with health issues live and some die? I can't answer that. Only God can answer that. There are times when our desire for complete healing is here on planet Earth. And God's plan for complete healing is in His loving arms. And this simply calls for faith on our part. That doesn't mean it's easy, but that's what we're called to do. Matthew 6:10, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. If God already has a plan and knows the outcome, why should we bother praying? Why should we pray for others, for ourselves, for forgiveness? Because God tells us to. Have you ever stopped to think about the fact that even Jesus in His humanity struggled with prayer? Jesus knew He had come to this earth to be the all-sufficient atonement for our sins. He knew why He came to earth wrapped in human skin. He, who was sinless, took on the sins of the world on your behalf and my behalf. He knew the plan because He was and is God. But He was also fully human, and He knew what was coming: pain, humiliation, beating, suffering, death, resurrection, victory. Matthew chapter 26, verse 42 says, "My Father, if it is not possible for this painful thing to be taken from me, if I must do it, I pray that what you want will be done." And John chapter 12, verses 27 and 28 read, "Now my soul is deeply troubled. Should I pray, Father, save me from this hour? But this is the very reason I came. Father, bring glory to your name." Even Jesus struggled. He would have liked for there to have been a different outcome, and yet His purest desire was to bring glory to God. And ultimately, that should be our goal as well, to bring glory to God, no matter the circumstances, no matter our feelings, no matter our emotions. It should always be our desire to bring glory to God. Matthew 6:10, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Well-known Christian author and speaker Jennifer Rothschild said, "God is more concerned about our salvation than our comfort." I think there are times we all need to remind ourselves about that. So I'm going to be a Gentile and I'm going to repeat that. God is more concerned about our salvation than our comfort. Is God too busy to hear our prayers? No. I preached for a few years at First Presbyterian Church in Ballinger, Texas. A favorite parishioner of mine was talking to me one day, and he said he doesn't pray because he knows God is really busy, and he has a lot on his mind, and this farmer didn't want to bother God. Well, people, that's wrong. This is wrong. God is never too busy for you. He will always welcome you with open arms. Our daughter, Chelsea, lives here in Ruidoso with her husband and three children. Hi, Chelsea. She's a great communicator. She calls me almost every day, and sometimes she calls me three or four or five times a day. But I look forward to her calls, and I miss it when she doesn't call. I know her fears, frustrations, challenges, concerns, accomplishments, heartaches, and joys. I know her likes and dislikes. I know what makes her laugh and what makes her cry. And I'm honored that she takes the time to communicate with me. Can't look at her, I'll cry. I'm honored that she loves me and trusts me. But here's the thing. I can listen to Chelsea. I love Chelsea. And I care about the issues in her life. But I don't have the solutions. Now, believe me, I have my opinions. But I don't know the answers. I don't see the big picture. But our God does. This is where faith comes in. This is where talking to God comes in. This is why we need to do more than talk to our friends or family about what's going on in our lives. We need to pray. Holy Spirit, which is God living in us, is our answer. He knows the solution. He sees the big picture. He knows the outcome. Holy Spirit is your teacher, comforter, and guide. I didn't make this up. It's in the Bible. So pray, listen, and then speak or act or respond to your situations. Do you ever feel like God is not listening to you? If you do think that, it's the voice of the devil inside your head trying to destroy your relationship with God. So don't give up. Keep praying. God will never tire of you and will never stop wanting you to come to Him in prayer. God cares about every detail of your life. As children of God, we are told that our purpose is to become the light of the world. We're to become more and more like Christ. We do this through reading the scriptures, spending time with faith-filled friends, and through prayer. Not just talking to God, but listening to God, seeking His will, and living out the good plans He has for you. So let me ask you this. How much time do you spend listening to God? Listening for His voice. When He speaks to you, do you recognize His voice? Is it a voice with which you are familiar? If not, what are you going to do about this? Scripture tells us that the sheep know the voice of their shepherd. If you don't know or recognize the voice of the good shepherd when he's speaking to you, responding to you, teaching you, loving you, then one of my challenges to you today would be to work on that. Know the voice of your heavenly Father. When you pray, use your everyday language. I love to hear my son pray. When he comes for Thanksgiving, I always ask him to say the prayer. And he always starts out with, "Well, God, I love you, and I need you." And I love hearing that because it comes from his heart. These and thous are not necessary. Be real. Share your heart, your burdens, your desires, but also share your joys and your praises and the many ways you're grateful. In other words, be open and honest, leaving nothing hidden, no questions, thoughts, feelings, or heart cries left unsaid. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7 say, "Don't be pulled in different directions or worried about a thing. Be saturated in prayer throughout each day, offering your faith-filled requests before God with overflowing gratitude, telling every detail of your life. Then God's wonderful peace that transcends human understanding will guard your heart and mind through Jesus Christ." Something we need to keep in mind is God is not Santa Claus, and he's not a genie in a bottle. We should not just speak a list of wants, desires, and wishes in the air, and then it was saying amen, and then wake up in the next morning wondering why all of our wishes have not come true. This is not seeking the will of God. Matthew 6:10. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But what about when we are so heartbroken, so devastated, so sad, so contrite, that we don't even know where to begin to pray or what words to use? Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27 read, "Also, the Spirit helps us with our weakness. We do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself speaks to God for us, even begs God for us with deep feelings that words cannot explain. God can see what is in people's hearts." It's sitting in the sermon, but how pure your heart. Think about that, because what's in you is what's going to flow from you. Okay, end of that. And I'm ADD, okay? And he knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit speaks to God for his people in the way God wants. I'm going to read that last verse, verse 27, from another translation. It says, "God, the searcher of the heart, knows fully our longings. Yet he also understands the desires of the Spirit, because the Holy Spirit passionately pleads before God for us, his holy ones." Get that? We're his holy ones. "In perfect harmony with God's plan for our destiny." Now, the Sunday school class that I've been teaching in knows that I could probably spend the whole sermon focusing on just this one scripture passage. But in the interest of time, I will focus on just one phrase: God the heart searcher. God searches our hearts, not just to uncover what's wrong, but to fulfill the true desire of our hearts, to be fully his. That's our desire, to be fully his. And God is there for that. Grace triumphs over judgment. Here's the last thing I want to say to you. We as a country have turned our backs on God. We've allowed prayer to be taken out of our schools. Abortion, human trafficking, infanticide, and a complete loss of any moral compass have taken over the United States. In other words, evil is rampant. The internet, the World Wide Web isn't a joke. Everything we post, look at, study, peruse is public knowledge. Our freedoms are being taken away from us. But hear this. Prayer cannot be taken away from us. Our prayers are our heartfelt conversations with God, who is the extinguisher of evil and the champion of all that is good. Never stop talking to God. Never stop praying. Never stop allowing the light of Christ to shine through you. You cannot change the world through your own efforts. But as you allow the Holy Spirit to work in you, he can change the world through you. One smile, one touch, one prayer at a time. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the gift of prayer. Teach us to pray. And always, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
So if you wouldn't mind bowing your head for a moment of prayer, I'm going to do the offering a little bit different. So dear Lord, just thank you for bringing us all here together, God. And I just pray, you know, as my words are used today, I just pray that it is of you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And so, if you didn't know, there's four ways of offering. Because once again, I'm going to do that a little bit different. Usually I tell a weird story or a joke, but not a joke. Four ways to offer. The boxes are around the sanctuary. You can go online. You can email it in, whatever, text it. And so, some of y'all might notice I'm a little jumpy. I'm excited. Ask why I'm excited.
Why are you so excited?
So I was able to go to the West Plains Conference. Oh my goodness. And so I was, you know, I was like, oh man, it's conference. Like, how exciting can it be? It was exciting. And so if you don't know, the Global Methodist has a mission statement. Y'all know what those mission statements are? So the first one, I'll give you a hint. Worship. There you go. Worship extravagantly. And oh my goodness, that second night, our second day, we worshiped hard. It's like the word just came in, and then all of a sudden, just the Spirit hit us all. Lisa hit me, and immediately I was just like, oh gosh. And God's like, here's a fire. And then just, you know, go home and take it. And so I'm taking it to you guys. And so if you wouldn't mind, extend your hand to the cross. And so as we've been saying throughout the weeks, we're going into a new phase of our church, a phase that we need Jesus. And so this is going to be a little bit of a scary statement. I want you to say, your will be done.
Your will be done.
Say it again.
Your will be done.
There you go, guys. So when I ask you to do something as an associate pastor, remember, you said that statement. So once again, thank you guys for letting the team go that was able to go. And oh my goodness, I hope we're able to bring some of that fire to you guys. Because, my heart is on fire. And so if you wouldn't mind bowing your head for one more moment of prayer. Dear Lord, I just thank you for letting us go to this conference, God. And I just pray that as we are seeing what our conference is willing to do for you, God, that we're able to do that in this town. I pray that we're not just able to just bring the word to the people in this church, God. I pray that whether it's in Alto, Capitan, wherever, I hope we're able to bring the word to you, all these people, knowing that everyone, not just lower class, upper class, everybody needs you, Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
His grace and his light on every soul around.